Good evening or morning or wherever it is, wherever you are in the world, whatever time it is. We're happy you're joining us for another Olive Tree webinar. This one on strengthening marriage. If you've been with us before, you know you're in for some applicable both tips and ideas about how to support your marriage and probably how to support somebody else's as well. We're really delighted you're joining us today, if you're in person or watching this later on the website. I will say just right off the bat, before I introduce Steve, that this will be available as a resource on the website probably in about a week. Our specialist person that does that is out of the office this week, and so expect this to be up on our website with any handouts or resources that Steve will offer early next week, likely. We are happy that you're joining us today. We're glad to have each of you here live. Obviously, if you've joined us before, you know that means you get to ask questions or give feedback as Steve is presenting, as he's talking about this topic. And there will be a couple times in which Steve invites feedback from you. We invite you to do that via the chat function, as always. And so you'll see that you can chat with hosts directly. So if Steve is asking for feedback or questions, or you have questions for him that you'd like to send either throughout or at the end when he's eliciting those, please just message those directly to me, to Lisa, and I will communicate them with Steve just so we have an easy flow. At this point, I'm happy to introduce you to Steve Scruggs, Dr. Steve Scruggs, who is a psychologist. He just told me for 33 years, which is a wealth of experience. We argued about whether that meant he was old or he was experienced. And the answer is, in my book, that he's experienced. But we're happy to have his experience. He's talking about marriage tonight. And this is with his both professional opinion and experience, being 33 years a psychologist, but also the personal experience of being almost 40 years married to his lovely wife. So we've got some wisdom and experience speaking to us tonight on this topic. Steve is one of our full-time counselors at Olive Tree Counseling Center, and really the first of our counselors, our full-time counselors, that has been whether it's brave enough or silly enough to volunteer his very busy schedule already to presenting a webinar for you. So we're really delighted that he's agreed to do this. And so without further ado, I will turn it over to Steve.
Well, good evening or good morning, depending on where you are. Glad that you're here with us today. I will just introduce this by saying that sometimes as we're talking about this, I'll not only be sharing successes, but areas where it's been a challenge for me in that 39 plus years of marriage. Also, we'll be talking about problems related to marriage early on. And I promise you, we will get to the good stuff, what to do about it. But we will be talking about some problems related to that. Let's start, though, by just talking about a biblical basis of marriage. And, you know, I think these are very familiar verses here, right? From Genesis 1 and John 2. These are ones that are often quoted during marriage ceremonies when we either got married or when we go to a marriage. But I think the bottom line is God values relationships. And there's no more intimate relationship in this world than between a husband and a wife. And so this is an opportunity for us to really sort of dig into what can make a relationship better. And really, I believe that it really pleases God when Christian couples have an intimate, loving relationship. And because really that's God's design right from the beginning. And of course, you know, when people are struggling, many don't consider divorce an option. And, you know, these are, again, well-known verses that we've all read, probably heard preached on before about divorce and the problems related to divorce. And of course, part of it is Jesus was talking to a society where divorce was essentially, you know, something that a man could do to a woman and leave her destitute at any moment, just on a whim. So you have to keep that in context, but for many people who are believers, they really don't see divorce as an option. But unfortunately, the numbers tell a different story. When you look at the statistics, evangelical Christians or people who identify themselves as evangelical Christians have really similar divorce rates to the general public. And in fact, in some states, divorce rates for those who list themselves as evangelical are actually higher than the general public. Now, in fairness, those states are often southern states where there's a lot of poverty, and poverty is another thing that's associated with divorce. But if you look at these numbers here, they're pretty startling. About half of marriages will end in divorce. And the other problem is that getting divorced really doesn't work out for most people. And so if you look at the numbers, second or third marriage actually is more likely to end in divorce. So again, some of the bad news. Further bad news is divorce is really hard on kids. And so when it comes to pretty much any measure you can think of, kids who are in families where there's divorce really do worse. And so whether it's school, whether it's behavior, whether it's just personal adjustment, how they feel about themselves, how they get along with others, all of those are negatively impacted by divorce. And I think something that's particularly of concern to people who are of faith is that actually there's changed practices in their faith after divorce. So the numbers, you know, unfortunately are sad and painful, that following a divorce, people are more likely to abandon their faith, and also that people raised in step families are less likely to be, quote, religious. Now, of course, you know, when we say religious, that's often done by poll workers who look at all kinds of different faith systems. But one of the things that I think is really important is that third point on this slide. And that third point is really important because it says there that religious practice has benefits in a lot of areas. And one of the areas is sexual restraint. And it says that it says in there it may lose their protection. Well, I decided not to just bore you with, you know, hundreds of horrible statistics, but one example, really striking example, is that kids who grow up in homes where parents have gone through divorce, have their first sexual encounter significantly earlier, both boys and girls, and also they're much more likely to have premarital pregnancy. So those are just a couple of striking examples. So, you know, the alternative is that Christian parents who are unhappy often stay together, but the reason why they do it is kind of for the kids. And you know, sometimes they consider it sort of the noble thing to do, right? It's the, you know, I'm going to do the right thing, even though I'm unhappy in my marriage. And there's lots of reasons why, right? And so you get a good listing here, but I think it starts for a lot of us with internal pressure. You know, let's face it, nobody gets married to get divorced, right? That's not anybody's plan when they get married. And so, you know, most of us, when going through a difficult time, would say the last thing we want is a divorce. Of course, there's lots of other reasons, right? There's a lot of social pressure. There's a lot of pressure from the church. There might be pressure from both your immediate family and also your extended family. Your spouse may also be putting pressure on you. And gender roles and expectations. I think this is particularly true of women, that kind of the idea that for women, a lot of times there's a greater expectations for women in terms of sort of holding the family together. That's not necessarily fair. That's not necessarily accurate or right, but that is kind of our cultural belief. And then of course, there's many people who are unhappy who stay together just because of their values and beliefs. They just think it's the right thing to do. So even though their marriage is struggling, they stay together because of their values and beliefs. So what are some of the common steps in marital dissatisfaction? And I put this together based on my own experience. So I'm sure I've missed some things, but boy, I've seen this a lot when I talk to couples that are struggling. So a lot of times it starts off with just simple boredom. You know, it's not exciting anymore. And the research, for instance, shows a kind of a normal pattern. There's a great deal of physical intimacy in the first 2 years of marriage, and that naturally decreases over time. It's not necessarily a sign of a problem in and of itself, but when it's followed by all these other things, I'm getting a little bit of a sound. I don't know if anybody else is. It's like a whirring sound. So So decreased emotional intimacy is a critical piece and something we'll be talking about later. So then what happens is partners become more and more disengaged over time. They just don't connect. And then oftentimes what happens, almost as a respite, they fall into the next patterns, which is preoccupation with the kids and preoccupation with work. And so you might kind of say it's sort of a chicken or egg problem. Which comes first? Marital disengagement, so therefore I'm going to invest all my time and energy in the kids or in work, or I invest a lot of time and energy in the kids or at work, and therefore we get more and more disengaged. Now, another thing that's often an issue in marital dissatisfaction is changing views of marital roles. As women's roles change in society, sometimes it's a struggle. And frankly, it's usually a struggle for men who struggle with the idea that their wives may have a larger role outside the home than they considered initially. So people begin to feel lonely when they're disengaged, they're preoccupied with things other than their spouse. And that loneliness leads to disappointment, frustration, and eventually somewhere between exhaustion and fed up. So I may just be tired of it, or I may be fed up with it. And then what I experience in talking to people who are in this situation, they begin to fantasize about another life. Oh, if they had a different partner, things would be better. And then comes separation. Finally, you know, I call it divorced in all but name, meaning that we're not together, we're not a couple, but we haven't just signed the papers yet. And then finally divorce. So when you look at these things, you know, you can see it starts slowly and builds over time. And this becomes, unfortunately, a very predictable pattern. So here's some other barriers to intimacy. Over-focus on work and ministry, financial problems, excessive spending, and porn use. Let me just take a minute and talk about these. So when I meet with couples who are struggling, oftentimes I'll ask them, and often it's the guy, but not always, sometimes the wife, not the husband, I'll say, what's more important, your work or your family? And that's an easy thing to answer. No brainer, right? My family's more important. But then I ask him a second question. What's more important, your ministry or your family? And oftentimes there's a pause. And when that pause occurs, then that tells me a lot. And there's a real struggle there, because a lot of times that family member who's at home feels that every day. Financial problems, unfortunately, hit people at every income level. I've worked with people who are what I would consider quite wealthy, who struggle with financial problems. And I've dealt with people who are, you know, really struggling on the edge who deal with financial problems. And then porn use is an increasing problem. 25 years ago, this wasn't an issue, right? Because most people didn't even have access to the internet. But starting about 25 years ago, people started getting access to the internet. The number one most frequent website out there are porn sites. And so when people are bored, lonely, frustrated, then this can become sort of a go-to, an unhealthy go-to. And I'll just add that, you know, for people in my generation, they didn't really grow up with that, but people the next generation before me, that really is something they grew up with. So it might be a longstanding pattern that started really in childhood. So a 12-year-old now has access to porn very readily. So my first question for you all is really this one. If a person is unhappy in their marriage, they may feel trapped. And so my question to you all is kind of asking you, what do you think about these different options? What do you think if hopefully not your own situation, but if that's the case and you're unhappy in your marriage, it might be your own situation, or just the people that you come across, work with, see in your daily life. What do you find is most common? So here's some obvious ones here: leaving the kids with only one parent in the house, financial uncertainty, and, you know, for cross-cultural workers, this is huge in terms of end of ministry. Oftentimes divorce means end of ministry. And not only the shame and guilt that a person might experience, but really a loss of identity. Because a lot of times in America, our culture is such that we define ourselves based on the work that we do. And I'm not saying, again, that's right or good, but that's our kind of cultural norm. Of course, people feel trapped and they may be worried that if they divorce, they'll be alone or that they'll be going against God's plan. I'm sure there's others as well. So I'd like to give you just a minute or two, if you would, to send in your chats what you think are the most common problems that sort of people face when they're unhappy in their marriages and make they struggle about whether or not to get a divorce.
So feel free to send those chats my way.
I will just add that if I miss some that you think are common or that you've seen, please add them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, somebody is suggesting that it's a bad testimony or it feels like it's a bad testimony to be divorced. It's also giving up an ideal, the ideal of what life would be or should be. Somebody else is difficult to disappoint God and the other people you serve in ministry.
Okay. So it does leave a lot of people feeling trapped. They may be unhappy in their marriage, but they feel like they can't get out of the marriage or leave it because divorce doesn't feel like the right thing. And it may be a lifelong, you know, held conviction that is really important to the person.
Somebody else says in the country they live in, it's all about the kids. You can't divorce because of the children. Sure. Other people are mentioning that it's not the real solution. It doesn't feel like it's the real solution to the problem. And it feels like a failure as a Christian.
And today we're not going to be talking about the most extreme problems that where divorce might be justified. We're talking about more like routine problems. So when I talk about more extreme problems, I mean things like severe problems like sexual assault in marriage, or physical assault in marriage, or affairs in marriage. That's not really gonna be the focus of my talk today. I'm talking more about just families or couples that just drift apart. So there may be times when divorce, obviously, people might look at it quite differently if those kind of extreme problems come up. Well, moving on, I think what we see more often is people sort of trapped in mediocrity. And so what I mean by that is that people say, you know, it's not like we don't get along or that we argue a lot, we just don't communicate. Or, you know, we're just kind of going our own way. Some people describe this as sort of like railroad tracks. You know, so railroad tracks, you know, they go off in the distance and they never really connect. They never really get very close. So the advantage of that is there's not a lot of conflict. The disadvantage is there's not a lot of intimacy. So let's talk a little bit about different stages of a marriage. So, and you know, I put on there kind of depending on who you ask. And so with all three of these different versions here, you can sort of see the same pattern, right? And if you ask 10 experts, by the way, you'll get 10 different answers on this one. But all of them will start with something like the romance stage or the passion stage or the honeymoon stage. And everything's wonderful. My partner's amazing. I did have a couple that I worked with once who literally had a shotgun wedding. But outside of that, most of the time, there really is this romance stage. And this passion stage is exciting and wonderful and amazing. But if you notice, every one of these patterns kind of has something that comes next. And the descriptions vary, right? Disillusionment, misery, power struggle, realization, rebellion, but all of these are pretty indicative of the fact that that honeymoon stage doesn't last forever. But we love that honeymoon stage. It's so amazing, and we want it to last and be forever. And so I have a little video clip here for you of an example of the honeymoon stage. So the setup on this video clip is, it's from a movie called Dan in Real Life with Steve Carell. And the setup is that there's a family get together, and the teenage daughter's boyfriend sort of snuck across state lines to the family get together, and their dad catches him. And then of course sends him home. And this is the dad sending him home. So the teenage daughter and their boyfriend being sent home. At least I hope it's gonna happen. It didn't play. Oh, please tell me it's going to. Well,
Steve, I think if you switch the screen that you're sharing, it's open in your other window still. If you can exit out of the full screen.
Exit out of full screen? Mm-hmm. Sorry, you guys. I thought we had this worked out.
Go down to your internet, your Chrome window. There we go.
Let's try that.
Come say goodbye. Window.
I miss you okay, so much. Dad.
She'll see him again soon enough.
That's sweet.
What's sweet? How's that sweet?
It's okay. It's okay. To be that certain to feel so much love.
Is it a feeling?
No.
It's an ability.
Well, if that's true, you have one gifted daughter.
You are a murderer of love!
That come through to everybody?
Yep.
So hopefully you're not a murderer of love, but that gives an illustration of that passion that we experience early in a relationship. And unfortunately, it doesn't stick around. So one other stage model that I like is this one, which is the stage one, of course, romantic love, but then stage two, in this case, it's kind of combined disillusionment, distraction. But what I see with Christian couples a lot of times is sort of stuck there on stage three. There's either disillusionment or adjustment with resignation. And honestly, that's what the rest of this talk is about. It's about helping those couples that are kind of adjusted with resignation. In other words, this is all I'm going to get. This is just kind of how it is, and I'm sort of stuck with it. Obviously, adjustment with contentment would be a better alternative. And so my hope is that the things that we talk about from here on in are going to kind of be related to that. Now, there are a couple of things that I think would be good to think about. Finally, some good news I have here. Different studies have found that when people are going through difficult times, those who sort of struggle through those difficult times, more than 90% say, I'm glad we stuck it out. And here's another way of thinking about it. This is a woman, Michelle Wiener Davis. She does a website called divorcebusting.com. And she sort of dedicated her career to this whole thing because what she found was when she started as a marriage therapist, most of the couples that came in were really just saying, I want the easy way out. I'm just tired and frustrated, and I don't really want to fight for this relationship. And so she started doing her own research and experience with couples. And, you know, she came up with her own stages. And of course, the first one is passion prevails, but then the second one was, of again, what was I thinking? And what she found is that, of course, what we all want is the other person to change. And eventually a person gets to a point of acceptance. And I love this quote that she uses. And that is, I'm certain that if more couples realize there really is a pot of gold at the end of the rainbow, they'd be more willing to tough it out through the downpour. The problem is most people fool themselves into thinking that whatever stage they're in at the moment, that's where they will be forever. And so one of the key things is, yeah, getting through these stages. But I really think of marriage as an opportunity. And, you know, this is a very familiar passage, and some of you could probably preach this better than I will, so I won't try to preach it. But I will just say this, that I love this notion in verse 32, that this is a profound mystery. The relationship between Christ and the church is a profound mystery, and that somehow marriage reflects this mysterious, profound experience that Christ and the church and marriage somehow resemble each other. And if marriage is done right, it can actually reflect the relationship between Christ and the church. And I will just mention that last verse, which, you know, some of you probably read Eggert's book, Love and Respect. And one of the things I would just say about it is the genius of that book, and I say it's the same genius about the five love languages, is not the idea that men need to love their wives and women have to respect their husband, as if that's going to solve every problem in a relationship. And similarly with the five love languages, I'm sure there's more than five. I don't know how many there are. But the genius of both those books is the idea that what we naturally give to our partners may not be what they need. And if there's anything that I hope people get out of this, it would be exactly that. Realizing that a lot of times what we naturally give to our partners is not what they need in terms of being able to receive love. And that's the genius of those books. So here's the next question. So this is one I hear a lot, which is, if I serve God and focus on my ministry, my family will be okay. So really there's two or three questions in here. One of them is caring well for your family a ministry? Is it an important call from God? And is this statement true? If I serve God and focus on my ministry, my family will be okay. So why don't we take another minute or two and give people an opportunity to give their thoughts, pass them on to Lisa, who will share them with all of us.
Someone says, it's not true. Responding very simply that I think if I serve God and focus on my ministry, my family will be okay. Not necessarily true. Somebody else says your family should be first priority. Loving as Christ loved the church seems to be the highest calling, the first stage of ministering for him. So I think loving family as Christ loved the church is the first calling. Somebody else says, absolutely. Our ministry to our family is primary before our ministry outside of there. Scripture does say that to serve as an elder, you need to first show how well you serve your family. Somebody else says, think the gospel is clear in saying that we need to put family first. And somebody else says, for me, my relationship with husband and kids is my first ministry after loving the Lord. Seems to be some consensus on this.
So one of the challenges is that I've had many people in my office say something like this. That's what I believe, but that's not what I live. And so I think that's one of the challenges for cross-cultural workers. And of course, you know, there is a real challenge here. By the way, I think we'll get to another part that sort of responds to that a little bit. But one of the challenges we all face is that, you know, when we're dealing with couples, I'm sorry, guys, I'm backing up here. One of the things I've come to believe over time is that essentially this is the prosperity gospel in surprise. Sorry, in disguise. I'm having a little trouble with my words here, guys. Sorry about that. That the prosperity gospel says basically, like, you know, if you give more, God will give you more. But that prosperity gospel, unfortunately, I think most of us would reject. And yet I think a lot of times people find themselves falling into this. So here's the hard part. You know, on the bottom line is we all want to point the finger at somebody else, but we can only change ourselves. And, you know, the term servant leader is bandied about a lot. But one of the things that I often ask people who are struggling in relationships is, you know, do you take that same attitude of being a servant leader in terms of taking initiative and repairing or restoring your relationship with your partner? But a lot of people struggle with that. And I never thought I'd be quoting Tony Robbins, you know, who's like the cheer, rah-rah guy. But I actually found a quote from him I liked. And what he said is, things can only get better with your spouse if you communicate with the one person who can truly help you turn it around. And that's your partner. So here's one of the things that I see a lot. And here's another question for you all. What I see a lot in cross-cultural workers is that both partners are high in commitment. They're committed to the work and they're committed to each other, but there's a low level of trust. When I say trust, I don't mean like my partner's gonna go out and have an affair. What I mean is trust that I can really count on them emotionally, that they're gonna be there for me. They're gonna communicate with me. They're gonna care about my feelings. So why do you think this is? I'll give you all a minute or so to give your thoughts.
Someone wonders if it's just the cost of living overseas. Sometimes there's a lot of cost emotionally, and people can get emotionally depleted.
Sure. Everything's harder, right?
Somebody says some grew up in an environment of not being able to trust their family and have established thought patterns that keep them from trusting their new family. Mm-hmm.
So if you have a family, if you grow up in a family that's completely committed to ministry or has other problems and doesn't really take care of its own, then yeah, sure, that could happen.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, somebody else says you need to depend on your partner in cross-cultural settings to make it through. And so I wonder if sometimes you find you can't depend on them in some instances, then that lack of trust can grow as well.
And oftentimes that network of family and friends that you had back in the States is not always just often not there overseas.
Mm-hmm. Somebody else says, if we've been hurt from our spouse in the past, emotional exposure is an area that we can protect this time around.
Yeah. So if you've been vulnerable and you've been hurt, it's very natural to want to protect yourself. So if there's other comments, go ahead and interrupt me, Lisa, but I'm going to move on because I think that this kind of goes back to the issue we discussed earlier as well, you know, being the main focus on ministry or work rather than family relationships. But, you know, some of these things, you know, I use the kind of that old saying, the best lies have a little bit of truth in them. And the part of the problem is that people working cross-culturally are engaged in really important work. And so it's very easy to imagine that people would get consumed by it. People feel responsible to supporters. But I think this is a crucial piece, this next one, which is people tend to focus on the outcome rather than the process. So I need to have numbers. I need to have so many boxes checked. I need to show some kind of outcome for my work here, rather than acknowledging that ultimately it's God that does the work. And my job is just to do the process. Of course, we all have the danger of comparing ourselves with other people. And then, you know, this kind of goes to one of the earlier comments. We may have family of origin issues. Our family may have been very performance or productivity oriented. Our family may have been very critical. And our family may have kind of put work ahead of everything else. And we may have those just sort of as an assumption of what we should do. And then, of course, sometimes people have what we call false core beliefs that under stress, those beliefs that they kind of know aren't true become sort of their lived beliefs. Like, I have to do certain things in order to be accepted. Another common problem, and this has really changed, and this is, I guess, one of the advantages or disadvantages of having done this for a long time. So I was a military psychologist early in my career, and if you'd asked me 30 plus years ago, you know, of these two different approaches, task-oriented versus relationship-oriented, who is task-oriented and who is relationship? I would have answered with confidence that men are task-oriented and women are relationship-oriented. Not necessarily today. But think about it. You know, the American way is to be task-oriented. And I know we have some people who are from other cultures, but I suspect this is really common in the Western world, which is identify the problem, come up with a solution, implement that solution, and evaluate the results. If it works, great, move on to the next problem. If it doesn't work, start over again. What's the problem? What's the solution? Implement it, evaluate. And so you just get real task-oriented. And oftentimes that's very successful on the job. But the problem is that when you try to do that with relationships, it doesn't work that well because relationships are about something different than just completing tasks. It's about connecting. It's about sharing thoughts and feelings. It's about providing support, giving and receiving that support. It's about enjoying the journey and creating memories. And, you know, for a perfect example for us, and me and my wife would be driving on vacation. So you can probably guess that we are more stereotypical in that I want to get there in the fastest way possible, which usually means starting early, beating the traffic, making as few stops as possible, and making sure we get there. But I've had to learn over almost 40 years that I'm missing the journey and I'm missing the opportunity to create memories. And so I've seen increasingly the roles are reversed. There's more and more women who are on the job, very good at solving problems and completing tasks. And yet when they come home, they're sort of making the same mistakes or having the same problem that men traditionally have had. So one key piece of turning the corner on a relationship is recognizing that completing tasks is not the goal in a relationship. But there are really different goals. And I think that there's other things that culturally kind of affect us. And I want to say right up front that minimalism is, I think, one of the ones that is affecting us. And I think it's a reaction to first world excess. And I think many cross-cultural workers kind of fall in line with this because they realize that their counterparts in America are more focused on things and stuff. And so they make a point to reduce purchasing and belonging, and they cut out all but what is completely necessary. But unfortunately, this can be a source of conflict. And not only a source of conflict, but even a source of pride. And I have to admit, I tell people I'm a reforming minimalist. I'm not completely reformed, but I'm reforming, meaning that I think it's easy for those of us that are minimalists to say, I don't need all that stuff. All that stuff is extraneous, whatever stuff is, meaning anything I don't want. And this is just sort of a, I saw this and I thought, well, this kind of reflects minimalism, right? I saw this painter's painting and I thought, okay, he didn't even bother to paint the whole picture, right? Just the bare essentials. And so, you know, we might chuckle about this, but I think it can be a source of real conflict for couples. So I heard a podcast with this gentleman, Greg McGowan, and I thought, this is a better way to think about this. And so he wrote a book, The Disciplined Pursuit of Less. And he does talk about things that sometimes sound similar to minimalism. And these are just a few of the examples of things that he said. For instance, don't let your tombstone read. He checked his email. But the key thing is, if you don't prioritize your life, someone else will. And so I kind of think of it like this. Essentialism in marriage changes the conversation and causes you to ask different questions. So the standard kind of questions that we tend to ask is, well, what do you really need? I know there's things that you might want, but what do you really need? And essentially, we only need things like food, clothing, and shelter. But do we really need just food, clothing, and shelter? Because what did Jesus say? We don't live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God, right? So if you change that whole discussion from what do you need to what restores you, what fills you with satisfaction, what gives you peace, what do you need to thrive? That's a whole different discussion. So just in my reform minimalism, for instance, my wife loves houseplants. And they help her to thrive. But you know, I don't care a bit about houseplants, but I used to complain about them all the time. And now I only occasionally complain. and similarly, my wife has taken up art recently and last few years. And you know, those art supplies, they just excite her. They restore her. They give her a sense of accomplishment. And I'm always excited now. Before I was like, why do we need this stuff? And now I can be excited for about it because I realize it's essential for her to thrive. So I've stopped asking the what do you need question and asking these other questions. And I encourage couples to do that. You know, and kind of the other side of it for me is something that I think is defined well by John Eldridge in Wild at Heart. And, you know, he kind of says it sort of tongue in cheek. He says, you know, Christian masculinity has been reduced to kind of just being a nice guy. But he sort of says tongue in cheek, is that every man's childhood dream? You know, my goal when I grow up is to be a nice guy. And similarly, is that what every woman dreams of when she's, you know, a girl? My Prince Charming is going to be a nice guy. So part of what it's about too is encouraging rather than discouraging what caused you to thrive. For men, I think it's often some sort of adventure. And when I say adventure, I don't mean doing stuff that's stupid or life-threatening, although I will say that for my 62nd birthday, my wife gave me as a birthday present something that was on my bucket list, which was jumping out of an airplane. And that's particularly hard for somebody who's former Air Force psychologist, you know, who in the Air Force, we say we don't jump out of perfectly good airplanes, but I did, and it was great fun. Here's another example. In the summer, we were planning on coming over here to Antalya, and we couldn't come because of COVID. And so we went on a road trip, you know, kind of out in some quiet, wild places. And so one of my goals during that time was to hike Humphreys Peak. It's the highest place in Arizona. So my wife likes to hike, but, you know, 5 miles straight up a mountain over 12,000 feet was not her idea of a nice day. So she said, go for it. And that's an example of essentialism. She realized that's something that's important to me, to have that adventure, to be able to do something different and exciting. And I think that's something that really helps couples. Now, I want to move on to some more sort of traditional thoughts about couples. And this is kind of lessons learned from John Gottman and his research, over 3,000 couples. And believe it or not, people were crazy enough to go into a place kind of like an Airbnb that had cameras and microphones and just allow themselves to be recorded. And when they got to the kind of to the end of this research, over 3,000 couples and kind of coding the ones that are doing well and the ones that aren't doing well, they kind of came up with a description. There are certain couples that are masters of relationships, and there are certain couples that are disasters of relationships. And then they kind of took it a step further. They said, is it possible that we could teach the couples that are disasters of relationships how to do the same thing that the masters do? And what they found is, in fact, they could. And so I'm going to go through four of the most common problems. And these are so problematic in relationships that the Gottmans, you know, use the apocalyptic language of Revelation. They call them the four horsemen of the apocalypse. They're the four horsemen of relationship distress. And these four horsemen basically escalate conflict and damage a relationship. And unfortunately, over time can be a pattern. But the antidotes are the ones that the masters do. And see, the difference between the masters and the disasters is not that they never do these four horsemen. In fact, all of us do. But that they don't stick with them. They don't become a pattern. And that's the key difference. So the first one is criticism. And, you know, probably anybody who's talked to a couple or been married doesn't have to really guess that this would be on the list, right? But it's not so much addressing problems. In fact, the Gottmans discuss this way. They say there's a difference between a complaint, which is identifying a problem, and a criticism, which is attacking the person. So you deal with the problem through harsh, blaming, or hurtful expressions. And so the focus is on, you know, like your flaw rather than the problem. Now, not surprisingly, when we criticize, it's often met with defensiveness. But the example there, this kitchen is a mess, you're such a slob. So the alternative is a gentle startup. And this sounds simple, but simple is not the same as easy. A crucial piece in any communication, and you can look at research study after research study, and this is not only in relationships, but in all kinds of communication. When I say not only in marital relationships, but all kinds of communication. How you start the discussion has a huge impact on how the rest of the discussion is going to be. So if I come in and say, this kitchen is a mess, you're such a slob, you can probably guess how the rest of the conversation is going to go. But if I say, I feel frustrated when dirty dishes are left in the sink, could you please do the dishes tonight? There's a much greater likelihood that that's not going to end up in the next 30 minutes being consumed with a big argument. Similarly, defensiveness. You know, we all have this natural tendency. What happened in the garden, right? It wasn't anybody's fault, right? Eve blamed the serpent, right? Adam blamed Eve, right? It wasn't anybody's fault, right? So deflecting responsibility for our mistakes is something we as human beings have been doing for a long time. Making excuses, shifting blame. It wasn't my fault I yelled. You were late, not me. So you caused this to happen. I'm not responsible. So all of us do this at times. But if you want to break that pattern, it's really important to take responsibility. Own up to the behavior without blaming. Don't take the feedback personally. Use it as an opportunity and show remorse. I even use the example here of even if you didn't do anything wrong, you can still take responsibility. I lived in LA for 6 years. And while I lived there, it wasn't uncommon for me to get caught in a traffic jam. And sometimes I'd be late. And at first, when I would be late, people would say, hey, you're late. And I'd say, well, it wasn't my fault. But over time, what I realized that I could take responsibility for the fact that I was inconveniencing them. And I could say, I'm sorry I was late. I was stuck in traffic, but I'm sorry for inconveniencing you. So even though it wasn't my fault, I still could take responsibility for my contribution. I was still inconveniencing them by being late. Now, contempt is not the most common problem, but it's actually the most destructive. And contempt is basically showing anger, disgust, or hostility. So sarcasm is one approach. Mocking is, I would say, a little bit more intense than sarcasm. Put downs or insults would be even more intense. And essentially they're a way of saying, I'm better, smarter, neater, tidier, you know, more responsible, whatever, than you. And the antidote for that is developing a culture of appreciation. And that culture of appreciation fosters that healthy relationship by showing respect to the other person and showing appreciation. So affection, recognizing strengths. You know, contempt is essentially saying, I'm going to focus on your faults. Fondness and admiration is, I'm going to focus on your strengths. Now, the last one is stonewalling. And this is emotionally withdrawing, shutting down, or going silent. And, you know, I think for me, probably like a lot of men, I was sort of taught that this was the noble thing to do. When you're mad, instead of lashing out, you know, I was kind of brought up with the kind of the notion, you know, you never yell at or hit a woman. You know, those were kind of those things. So I thought I was doing the noble thing by backing off, withdrawing, and shutting down. But unfortunately, what happened is it never resolves the problem. Now, in a minute, we're going to be talking about an alternative. But the important thing in this point is a lot of times the person is feeling overwhelmed, their heart rate's increasing. And maybe this is happening when their partner is criticizing. And so they just kind of think, if I say anything or do anything, it's just going to make it worse, so I won't say anything. But unfortunately, there's an old communication principle. When we feel like we're not getting through, we tend to say it again, and we tend to say it louder. Now, this is easiest to see with kids, right? When your kid is watching TV and you tell them to take out the trash, if they don't listen, what do? You probably say it again, and you probably say it louder, right? But think about how that works with partners. I feel like I'm not getting through. This person may be withdrawing because they're feeling overwhelmed. They don't know what to do. But if your partner is saying it again and saying it louder, you're probably just going to withdraw more, which means they're going to attack more, which means you're going to withdraw more, which means they're going to attack more. And you can see the spiral. So in this situation, it's really important to figure out an alternative. So here's what I recommend. You know, we all sometimes get so stressed that we're likely to say or do something we regret. Or we may feel so overwhelmed that we just need a break. And it's okay to take a break to calm down. In fact, what our research shows, and this is based on brain imaging studies, for instance, that it takes about 20 minutes before the brain can think clearly when we're in that state of just being overwhelmed, or we sometimes describe it as being flooded. And so we actually need that amount of time before this part of our brain that's kind of the problem-solving part actually works. So there's really two keys to making this break work. And one is leave without what I call dropping a bomb. You know, so here's an example. You're making me so mad, I just got to get out of here. Now that's dropping a bomb, right? You're blaming it all on the other person as you leave. And of course, a lot of times people use much more colorful language than that, right? I'm giving you the G version. So what's much more helpful is take responsibility for why you're leaving and tell your partner that you are coming back. I'm really upset. I need to calm down right now. I'm so mad I might say or do something I'll regret later, and I don't want to do that. I'll be back in 20 minutes or a half hour. Now, when you're really mad, the best you may be able to do is just say, I need to go take a break. And it's really helpful if you and your partner are in this pattern to talk about it in advance and say, you know, honey, I love you and I don't want to say or do something I regret, or I'm just feeling overwhelmed and I need a break so I can work on this problem. And if you can do that at a time when you're calm and not in the middle of an argument, it makes it easier to be able to do this in the midst of an argument. Now, the other side is, you know, if you're in the middle of an argument and you want to make your point, it's really hard to let your partner go. And in the most extreme of versions, I've had couples where that one partner blocks the doorway. You're not leaving until we solve this. But what's more common is going fishing. Now, what do I mean by that? What I mean is this, is that you know what really gets to your partner. And so if they're getting ready to leave, but you're not done making your point, what you do is you put a big juicy worm on the hook. And as they're leaving, you take that fishing pole and you throw it out there and just leave it for them to bite on, right? And there's many versions of this. If you really cared about us, you wouldn't leave. A real man doesn't walk away from his problems. A mom who really cares about her family stays and solves problems. You know, I could go on, but you get the idea. The thing is that your partner knows what really gets you. And so that juicy worm is right there. And if you bite on it, they reel you back in and then you're back at button heads. Nobody wins in that situation. So if you can leave without dropping a bomb, if you can let your partner go without going fishing, that can really make a difference. So what are the goals of therapy? You know, when we talk to couples, one of the things I tell people is our goal is just not to get rid of the problem areas, but also to add good interactions. And so how do you do that? And we're not going to have time to go through all these in detail today, but I do want to just mention stress-reducing conversations, meaning that people take focus time every day to sit and talk to each other. Most experts recommend about 10 minutes for each person. And interestingly enough, when we do research on kids, we find out if they get one-on-one direct interaction, not distracted by anything else, not doing chores with a parent and a child, they do a lot better. And it's the same thing seems to be true with partners, with couples. There's something about us as human beings that we need a certain amount of undistracted, focused attention every day. And so stress-reducing conversations, taking about 20 minutes a day to do that. And what that does is it builds the emotional bank account. It means that you're making deposits in the relationship and your partner knows and trusts you. So that when bad things happen, there's a deposit, there's something to take it out because bad things are gonna happen. We all have bad days. And what that does too is it helps to create a culture of appreciation. And you can also do that through rituals of emotional connection. Little things like when you say hello in the morning, when you say goodbye at night, when you're leaving for work, when you come back from work, with events, big and small, birthdays, other celebrations, even hard times, having rituals that pull you together. And recognize and respond to bids for emotional connection. When your partner reaches out, don't ignore them. Pay attention. And I kind of think of it like this. There's sort of two phases to getting closer. One of us having deep conversations. That means where I can really tell you what I think, what I feel, and what I want. And that opens the door for hard conversations. Hard conversations is when we have a disagreement about something important. And we both might have great reasons for why we think what we think, but we're just on different ends of this. Examples might be spending versus saving. It might be where we go on vacation, how we spend our time. But the goal would be ultimately get to the point where you're supporting each other's goals and dreams. You know, when my wife said to me, you know, hey, I'm excited that you want to hike Mount Humphreys. And I can't do the whole thing, but I'll hike the first part with you. And you just go on and do it. That was a great day for me. When I finally said to my wife, instead of complaining about the houseplants, I get that you really need these houseplants. That was a good day for her. And so I will just add that when my wife was 55, she decided to go back for a master's degree. And being the practical guy and the numbers guy, I asked her some questions like, are you going to make more money? No, the answer was no. Are you going to have better work hours? The answer was no. We had two kids in college at the time. You know, and everything about that said practically it wasn't really worthwhile. But you know what? It was important to her. And that's one of the things that she shared with me. It's always been one of my goals or dreams to work with higher level students. She was an educator in nursing, and she had to get a master's degree to teach at the local university in the nursing program. And so it was important to her. It was a goal for her. It was a dream for her. And so sometimes what's important is not what's practical. And sometimes what's practical is not ultimately what's more important. So keeping that idea in mind, I think, is important. Now, I want to kind of focus a few minutes on this notion of emotional connection. And, you know, Dr. Susan Johnson was a psychologist in Canada. And, you know, it's a well-known fact that attachment is necessary for human survival. And you've probably all heard the horror stories about kids in orphanages that have food and get their diaper changed, but they die at an alarming rate. And so we learned several years ago that attachment was not just something that was a nice to have, it's actually a must have. But people always attributed that to children, and they never talked about how much attachment might be important for adults. And so Dr. Johnson started doing research on this and found that, in fact, there's now over 20 studies out there that show that actually emotional attachment is crucial for adults as well as children. And so for those of us that are married, that place where we get our sense of attachment is most likely to be in our marital relationship. And that's a whole nother discussion about those that are single, but for those that are married, that's it. So the first thing, of course, not surprisingly, is what interferes with attachment in relationships. And so the three most common ones, according to Dr. Johnson, are what she calls the demon dialogues. These are the ones that tear us apart. And the difference between what Dr. Johnson has found versus what other marriage counselors talk about is that actually, when we try to connect with our partner and we're not able to, that's when these demon dialogues come up. So the first one is the protest polka. And this might seem a little bit familiar when you think about the four horsemen, but one partner is critical and aggressive, and the other is defensive and distant. And so what essentially is happening here is, I want to connect with you. I don't feel like I'm able to, so I become more and more critical and aggressive in an attempt to connect with you. But what happens is, of course, you get more defensive and distant because you don't like the criticism and the aggressiveness. And then soon both are assuming the worst. He doesn't care. She just wants to criticize. He doesn't care. All she does is just badger me all day. Now, another one is find the bad guy, right? It's your fault. No, it's your fault. No, it's your fault. No, it's your fault. And round they go. And then freeze and flee is, I maintain distance to maintain safety. So at this point, I'm not even trying to get close to you, because at this point, I'm just keeping my distance to keep emotional safety. And so these are classic examples of people who have tried to connect with each other, but then don't feel attached, don't feel close, and therefore they fall into these patterns. So how do you break that pattern? One of them is recognizing what we call the raw spots. You know, we all have sensitivities. Maybe you had a critical parent, or maybe you never felt like you fit in as a kid. Or maybe even things came easy to you at one time in your life and they're not coming easy now. And so part of it is recognizing the origin of where are you struggling with attachment, with connection? What's your raw spot? And then communicating this to your partner. And I'll be honest with you, this is difficult to do because it means taking a risk. And yet, if you can do that, then each of you begins to realize that the problem isn't your partner, it's those raw spots. In theological terms, I kind of think of it like this, that we often focus on personal sin, but oftentimes in our lives, we're also sinned against. And there's also sin in the world. And so the tendency for all of us is to focus on personal sin, and we forget that we're all sinned against. Those are the raw spots. Also, there's sin in the world, and those can also be source of raw spots. Learning to revisit those rocky moments. So how do you break out of the blame game? Well, part of it is kind of saying two things. And again, you can see the overlap with the four horsemen here, right? Can we recognize our contribution to the problem? And can we talk about this not so much what did you do wrong, but what was I hoping to receive from you? What did we want at that time? And what did you as my partner miss? What I was hoping right then is that you would say, wow, I'm sorry you're going through a hard time. Instead of, you know, why don't you just not worry about those people at work? You know, they're jerks. That may not be what your partner needs at that moment. So can you discuss it in terms of what they miss rather than just, oh, you don't even care? And really being able to engage and connect really involves three things. Being accessible, staying open to your partner, even when you have doubts and feel insecure. Again, there's a big risk here because it's easier to stay distant, right? Blame the other person and stay distant. But part of what that's about is also being responsive, accepting and prioritizing when your partner sends those signals saying that they need caring and they're showing caring. So instead of, well, now you think you can make up for it, instead say, I'm glad you're finally paying attention. This is really important to me. This is what I need. And then being involved and absorbed by your partner, being emotionally present. And those three things are really key to being close. And the way Dr. Johnson describes it, I think is really important, is that it's not just children who need to be held. We as adults need to be held also, but we need to be held emotionally. And yes, sometimes physically too, but she's really talking about emotional connection here. And frankly, that's the biggest antidote to boredom and disconnection in a relationship, is being accessible, responsive, and engaged. And you know, this is kind of an advanced skill, but forgiving injuries is what masters of relationships are able to do. They speak openly about their pain, and their partner stays emotionally present. You know, it's hard to do. Listening is hard. And yet listening is one of the most valuable gifts you can give your partner. And I often say to couples when I work with them, you never show the love of Christ or servant leadership more than when you listen. When you stay emotionally present and you acknowledge their pain. Now, when it comes to injuries, it takes it a step further in acknowledging your part in it. And honestly, when couples get stuck, a lot of times they get that I'll never trust you again message kind of going through their head. That's part of that distance, and that's part of staying safe. It's really much easier for them to get rid of that message if the person who's injured the other can take ownership and express regret and remorse. This goes back to, it's simple, right? This isn't complicated, but simple is not the same as easy. And then being accessible, responsive, and engaged. And what this does is it gives the opportunity to create a new story. That, yes, we had this injury. It eroded trust and connection. It led to these dysfunctional ways of relating. But now we're confronting it and healing it. We're going a different direction. And that's a key piece in forgiving injuries. Not that it's all fixed or solved, because it takes a long time sometimes to fix or solve injuries, but that we're in this process of change. We're building trust, we're engaging with each other, we're recognizing the mistakes we made in the past. So how do you keep your love alive? Well, one of them is you have to recognize those danger points. Remember those raw spots? You have to celebrate the positive moments, big things, littles, have rituals. And you have to recognize times when you disconnect and create that emotional safety. What that does, it creates a resilient relationship and a love relationship. I'm trying to keep an eye on the time here, Lisa. So I'm just gonna check real quick. So I'm gonna focus, I'm probably gonna skip the last part of my talk, which is on apologizing, but I don't wanna miss talking about sexuality. And so what does or does not lead to a good sexual relationship? And I'll just be honest with you, this is kind of an issue that unfortunately is, when we abandon it in the church, then we leave people with only the world's perspective on sexuality. So I just encourage people not to abandon this topic, with your kids, with your spouse, in your church, your ministry, whatever you're doing. But what do we find is associated with a poor sexual relationship and a good one. If you looked on the left and the right side of the screen, you could see this. But some of this is not rocket science, right? Again, it's simple stuff. But couples who spend little time together get focused on job and child. Usually that's husband and wife, but not always. Sometimes it's flipped. Talk mostly about what they need to get done, make the relationship low priority, and drift apart and lead parallel lives, have a poor sexual relationship. Remember the railroad tracks? That's kind of where they are. So what things lead to a good sexual relationship? You know, the traditional thing is, you know, unfortunately has been, again, the world's focus. Things like learning, how many shades of gray, you know, that kind of stuff. You know, learning about how to maintain an erection longer or be more responsive and orgasm. Unfortunately, that stuff is not associated with a better sexual relationship. These things are saying I love you daily and meaning it, kissing passionately, cuddling and showing affection. And I know you can't necessarily do it in public depending on your environment for some of you. Giving gifts and talking comfortably about sex, meaning that I want to know what you think. I want to hear where you're coming from. Having regular dates and staying good friends. All that stuff we talked about earlier about communicating, that's really what it's about. But one of the things that I think is really critical is just making sex a priority. Is it the last thing to do on your long list of things when there's nothing left in the tank? Well, probably it's not going to work out so well. The number one reason for sexual dysfunction is not deep, dark psychological problems. The number one reason for sexual dysfunction is fatigue. And so making sex a priority means that you don't wait until it's the last thing on a long list when there's nothing left in the tank. And then talking comfortably about sex allows people to know what's erotic for their partners. You know, some things might be exciting for you, but not for your partner, and vice versa. And if you don't talk about it, you just don't know. Now, one of the critical pieces of this that I want to just kind of end on, essentially, because we're not going to have time for apologizing, even though I think it's important, but creating a ritual for initiating and refusing sex. So when one partner reaches out for another, typically, and I won't say always, but typically it's a bid for emotional connection. It's a way of saying, I want to connect with you. But many partners avoid asking directly because they don't want the potential rejection that goes with that. And so what many partners do is they make indirect requests. How are you feeling today? And unfortunately, those indirect requests often lead to hope and also frustration. So what we found is actually more helpful is to have a clear bid for affection and sex. Of course, not surprisingly, they're much more likely to be accepted if they're clear and if they're personal. If you say to your partner, you know, I'm horny, that's clear, but it's sure not personal. That's about me, right? If I say, I love you and I really want to spend time with you, that's personal. That's relational. And ironically, when people make clear and personal bids for sex, 85% of the time, it's accepted. Now, the flip side and what often causes people to avoid asking directly is how people refuse sex. And so, you know, kind of the stereotype is that men always want sex and women don't want sex as often. That's not always the case. It goes both directions, I promise you. But it's perfectly okay to ask for sex and it's perfectly okay to refuse sex. The crucial piece is how do you do it? If you ask for sex in a way that's clear and personal, you're much more likely to be accepted. But if you refuse sex, it's important. I kind of say it as refuse the person like it's somebody you love, right? So do it gently. I love you and find you attractive, but I'm just not in the mood right now. It's perfectly okay to refuse sex. It's perfectly okay to not be in the mood. And it's perfectly okay to tell your partner that. Just do it gently. Recognize that this is a bid for emotional connection. And there's a million alternatives out there. And, you know, I'm not going to tell you what's the right one because there's a million out there, but let me just give you a couple of examples. I'm not in the mood right now, but, you know, I know later this week I won't have such a busy schedule, so I'll make sure that we have time together. Another example is, you know that I'm really distracted right now, so I wanna spend time with you when I'm really able to focus and show you how much I care. The key thing is that it's okay to say no, just say it gently. But I think it's also really important to discuss how you like to be approached by your partner. Everyone's different. Some people say, I need to kind of get in the mood, I need to get in the mindset, so tell me in advance. Other people say, I really like a romantic gesture. So for instance, a note, maybe a clever note on the bathroom mirror would be really nice. Maybe a kiss would be a good way to start, and let's just sort of see what happens afterwards. But the point is that you talk to each other about what you find romantic, what you find interesting, what you find makes you feel warm and cuddly with your partner, rather than just sort of presuming that whatever makes sense to you works for your partner. You keep seeing the same theme, which is communication. So the difference between a good marriage and a bad marriage is not whether you have different opinions. It's not even whether or not you argue. In fact, some research suggests that couples that describe themselves as having a good marriage argue almost similarly with couples who say they have a bad marriage. It's really about whether you can connect and also about whether you can dialogue about perpetual problems and learn to accept or even appreciate those differences. You know what? I'm always going to want to get to that vacation spot the fastest way possible. But over time, I've come to appreciate my wife's approach of saying, hey, let's enjoy the journey actually makes some sense. And even though my preference would still be there to get there the fastest, if I can just recognize that, hey, my way is not the right way, my partner's way actually does make sense. Enjoying the journey is important. And you know what? Those differences may never change, but at least we can accept and respect each other. And then be able to repair after the inevitable conflicts where you're just not at your best, because we're all going to have days like that. Well, I'm going to skip you guys the part on apologizing. It'll be on there. But I will just say, sorry, here we get back to the summary and just say, oh, here we go again. You know, marriage really is a gift from God. Conflicts can turn it into a nightmare, though. So the key is to break the patterns that impair your ability to be emotionally connected and do the things that help you feel close to your partner by making the relationship a priority. Cherish that connection with your partner and work to repair the relationship as soon as you notice that disconnect. So with that, I think I'm going to wrap up and just open it up for any comments or questions. You all have a lot of shared wisdom. So I'd love if you have a comment that says, here's what I've found really makes a difference in marriage. I'd love to hear it and have you share it with others. Or if you have a question, love to hear that as well and do my best to try to give you some help with that.
Yeah, while you're thinking about those, I'll just say that Steve's some notes will be up from this talk on the website after we put the recording up. And I think the notes about apologizing will be in there, so you won't miss it entirely.
Right. We'll give it a minute to see if there's any comments, if you have any thoughts about what really helps marriage strengthen, please add them. And also, if you have any questions, please, we'll just give you a minute or two to see if there's any of those before we wrap up.
Somebody mentioned, we found that taking walks when we have conflict allows us to calm down and think out what we say in a safe environment.
A great suggestion. By the way, I'll just mention, as a psychologist, I sit and listen to people all day long. So when I come home, of course, what my wife wants to do is sit and talk. But I've kind of been doing that all day. So one of the things we found is really helpful for us is also to take walks. Because then I can really pay attention. I can really focus. And also we can enjoy spending time together at the same time. Any other thoughts or comments?
There's a question about just resources. What's a helpful book or podcast, or where do you direct people to kind of digging deeper into this or finding maybe more along the lines of what you're talking about?
I would recommend three things. I took a slide out that I was thinking about. And I actually don't think this is the best book out there, but I think sometimes it's a good place to start. It's called Sacred Marriage. And this book says, the thesis of this book is, what if God made marriage not to make you happy, but to make you holy? And I do think that there's some value in that. Now, by the way, I don't think that God just made marriage to make us holy. I think he also made marriage to make us happy. But I think it's helpful to think about that, because our American kind of mindset in particular is sort of like, I want three steps to fix this and move on. And I think that's useful. I really like Created for Connection, which I referenced here in the PowerPoint. I think that's a really good book. I think the Gottman's book is also a good book. I think for some people, especially for couples that have more traditional views of marriage, Love and Respect is a very good book. For people who have less traditional views of marriage, I don't think it's as good a book for them. So I think part of it is depending on a person's view of marriage, if some books are more helpful than others. Marriage Buster, divorcebusting.com, by the way, is also a good resource.
Great. Somebody else is just sharing a helpful practice, and they said, get away and leave work and ministry at home. So getting away together, I think taking time away from home and ministry together, it's been a helpful practice.
Great suggestion. You know, I know for me, I can relax at home. But my wife has a much harder time relaxing at home, because she feels like there's 25 things calling for attention. And so she just needs to get away sometimes to be able to relax fully. And so that's different for me. And so part of it is kind of saying, it's not just about what I need, it's about what my partner needs.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, with all of that in mind and with an eye on the time, I think we'll wrap up here. This is been excellent, Steve. Thanks so much for sharing, for all this helpful information. As I mentioned before, handouts or kind of a summary of this and the recording will be available on olivetreecounseling.org by next week sometime. So check back there, or feel free to send this to friends or people in your organizations or teammates if it's been helpful for you. You're welcome as well to send in questions later if things come up for you. And of course, Olive Tree is a source for ongoing marital support if you find that you or somebody you know needs that. But until then, I hope this has been helpful for each of you. I know it's really good research, well-researched information. And thanks so much, Steve, for sharing.
Welcome. Thanks for all of you for participating.
We'll see you next time.